And so going into this session, I guess we could recap really quickly. Does anybody remember what Jared talked about a little bit last week? Kind of a highlight?
Yeah, I do.
Yes, sir.
I'm kidding. I'm not going to say it.
Like, what does chasing God kind of look like to pursue straining forward? Kind of talked a little bit about that.
Yeah, that's good. And then he also talked about, like, this goal, right? What's the goal or the prize of this chasing that Paul is chasing after?
Jesus.
Yeah, Jesus, right? I think, to quote Jared, the unhindered, fully realized presence of Christ, right? I had to, like, go back to the podcast and listen to it four or five times to make sure I wrote it down. But yeah, the unhindered, fully realized presence of Christ. I think that's the goal that Paul is chasing after. And Jared also kind of mentioned, like, this theme of like waking up and growing up, and that we excuse me, it was in reference to verse 16 where we're called to live in a way that was appropriate to the knowledge that we had received. And so moving on, before we read the text, I just wanted to cover kind of Paul's heart and his tone that we're going to see in these next few verses. And I feel that Paul's tone, or we're going to see, he's really emotional. He uses a lot of words of, like, endearment, of love. And for lack of a better phrase, I feel like he's pouring his heart out in this section. So in this this emotion that Paul has, I think we should keep this in mind as we go through this section, because I think it's going to be important. So if you have your Bibles, we're going to cover sections chapter 3, verse 17, all the way down to 4:2 if there's time. But I want to start with chapter 4, verse 1. And it says, "Therefore, my brothers, whom I love, long for, my joy, my crown." Do you see all the words that he's using there, talking and addressing the church? He says, "Stand firm thus in the Lord, my beloved." Do we see the words that he's using there? Mm-hmm. I need more interaction. Mark, this is not your word. Come on. Yes. All right. So I want to keep that in mind. Keep in mind that he has his love for the Philippians here. And I think that he gives them this command of standing firm in the Lord, and he's doing it in such a gentle way. It's not like he's using a scolding term, but I love how he's using this very gentle and reminding them that he loves and he cares for them and that he wants them to stand firm in the Lord. And I think that all the preceding verses that we're going to cover is like information in detail for the purpose that the believers would stand firm. Okay, so everything we're talking about, I think it's for the purpose of building a case and encouraging us to stand firm. And we'll talk about all that. All right? So let's go to verse chapter 3 again, 17. Can someone read from verse 17 to 4:1?
"Brothers, join in imitating me and keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example you have in us. For many of whom I have often told you and now tell you, even with tears, walk as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their end is destruction. Their God is their belly, and the glory, and they glory in their shame, with minds set on earthly things. But our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly bodies to be like his glorious body, by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself."
Awesome, thank you. So going back to verse 17, and he starts addressing them again, brothers. How many times does Paul use a word like that in the whole book of Philippians? A bunch, right? Like, he's just constantly referring to them. So he says, brothers. So again, he's using this word, and he says, brothers, join in imitating me.
Yeah.
And keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example you have in us. So when Paul says, join in imitating me, he's really referring to the pattern in life that he is living, that we see in all of the book of Philippians, of course, but also more closely in chapter 3. Can anybody point out some of the things that Paul was encouraging the Philippians to do from chapter 3? Anything come to mind? Do you guys remember?
Not put confidence in the flesh.
Yeah, absolutely. So Paul doesn't put confidence in the flesh. How about 3 verse 2? It's along the same lines of what Jerry was sharing. He's telling them to look out for the dogs, right? Look out for these mutilators of the flesh. Keep an eye out for these people. Be actively aware. Right? What else? What are some of the other things that Paul was doing?
Count everything as loss for the surpassing worth of knowing Christ.
Yeah, absolutely. So all of these things that Paul is talking about, these are all a part of the pattern of the life that he's living. And so he says, imitate me. Now, I don't think Paul's saying imitate me in a heart of arrogance or of pride, but I think he's doing it under the assumption of imitate me as I follow Christ. Right, and we see that in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 1, and it basically just says that. He says, be imitators of me as I am of Christ. So in the same way, that's his heart here. He's saying, I'm following after Christ, and in the same way, I long for you guys, I want you guys to imitate me, follow me in the same way. And I don't think it's just limited to Paul, right? Because he says, keep your eyes on those who walk in the example you have in us. The verb there is to keep your eyes. The eyes is like to notice, to consider, to look out for, to keep one's eyes on. And that's something we're supposed to do actively. But keep your eyes on the pattern. Again, keep your eyes on the pattern of life that you see in these people. Here we talk about the pattern. Cool. Some of these people, I think, that Paul was referring to were most likely the apostles at the time. I don't think they're just limited to the apostles, but we do know that Paul was there, maybe Timothy, maybe he's referring to Epaphroditus, right? These who have walked in a way that had an example, who have been walking in this pattern that Paul has described. But I don't think it's just limited to the apostles. I think he was opening up as well to the believers who were living in this way, the believers who had adopted this way of life, this pattern of living that was exactly how Paul's living. And I think in Scripture we do see examples of these believers, right, recorded. We have the writings and we have stories of how they lived. And I think we need to go there and imitate what they did, their pattern, rather. But in the same way, I think that we should also keep an eye on those who live this pattern now. And I think that's something that's appropriate for every context, for every culture, wherever church you're at. Let me ask you an easy question. Is there anybody in the church here that you can think of that walks in this type of pattern? Mm-hmm. Maybe a couple? Mm-hmm. Maybe they planted the church here?
Yeah.
Yes, thank you.
You're welcome.
Yes. Maybe Jared and Mary Beth, right? Yeah. I think Jared and Mary, I'm picking on you guys today. Yeah. I think Jared and Mary Beth are two people crazy in love with Jesus. I see them actively pursuing Christ. I see them actively growing in their relationship with him. But as we look at their pattern of life, come on, let's just be real. They're not perfect, right, by any stretch of the imagination. And they would agree to that. And I think that we should look at the areas of life that they're mature, that they are walking in this pattern that Paul describes. And we should be following them in that way. But I don't think that Paul's telling us when he says, imitate these people, I think he's saying imitate the pattern, the good pattern of maturity, right? I don't think if Jared had immaturity and maybe he was angry often, he wouldn't want us to follow him in that, right? He wouldn't want us to imitate him in that. Does that make sense? So in addition to that, in the same way that we look at leaders, I think that it's good for us to look at each other in the church, the true believers, and look at the type of pattern that they're living, the maturity. Because I think all of us are going to have different levels of maturity, right? Some of us are new believers, some of us are more seasoned believers. But I think each of us, even within time, we'll have different areas that we are more mature. So mm-hmm. if Jared is mature in a certain category, we should model him, imitate him in that way. And maybe if Melissa is mature in a different area, then we should model out her. And so I encourage you to look, keep your eye. And I think that's what Paul wants, right? He says, keep your eye on these people, notice these people. Not the people, but the pattern. Okay? All right. And I guess again, going just being reminded of this tone that Paul has, right? Remember his heart for these people. He cares about them so much. He loves them. I think that that he does have this encouraging tone versus like a scolding tone. And I think that because of his love for the believers, he does want to share a warning with them. And it's a serious warning. And again, he's going to pour his heart out here. And he goes into verse 18, right? So in light of this, he says, many of whom I have often told you about and now tell you about, even with tears, they walk as enemies of the cross of Christ. Paul's saying, I've told you about these people before, and even now as I'm telling you, I'm tearing up, right? It's an emotional thing, and these people are walking as enemies of the cross. And I just imagine Paul. Remember, he's in prison, and he's writing, and I can just imagine as he's writing and thinking of what he wants to write and communicate, that the pictures of each of their faces are just popping in his mind. Right, he knows the names of these people who are now enemies of the cross, and his heart is just broken. He's just crying, and you know, when I was thinking about this, I was like, well, what's the big deal? Why are you crying over them, over these people? And the main point there is that they're walking as enemies of the cross of Christ. And Paul further he talks about that, and he says their end, verse 19, their end is destruction. What is he talking about there?
Hell.
Yeah, really very simply. He's just talking about hell. And it's this place where these enemies of the cross, these people, are going to be for eternity, a place separated from the presence of God for all eternity. It's an awful thing, and that's why Paul's crying, right? He longs for these people to know him.
Sin, you could... It also leads to like destruction in this life.
Mm.
You see, if you're walking in sin, you see
mm-hmm.
destruction now.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, that's good. Sin absolutely has consequences now. That's great. So yeah, the future. The future condition is going to be hell, right? And I think that's the seriousness of this section. Paul saying imitate him. I think we need to take a moment to just think about that. Why is Paul spending so much time or spent a verse there talking about imitating him? And then he goes on to say, because there's people that are walking as enemies of the Christ, enemies of the cross. It's not a hypothetical situation. It's a reality. These people are walking against the cross. They are enemies. We'll just continue. So in verse 19, he says, their end is destruction. And he describes the way that they're living. He says, their God is their belly, and they glory in their shame with mindsets on earthly things. So he first describes that their God is their belly. Some translations might say stomach. We have any other translations? translations that say something different. Their God is, So their God is their belly. And it's this idea of this inner being of themselves, right? They worship their this thing inside of them. It has to do with reference to like an appetite or their, their appetite, their inward desire, their self-indulgent feelings that they want to appease, right? And I was thinking about this concept of worshiping a God, right? And I thought that this might be helpful, right? So, if this was their stomach, right? Like their inner being, their appetite, their desires, right? And they want to worship this thing, or they are worshiping it. I would worship it by giving it what it wants, right? I would give in to its desires. I would live in such a way that I would fulfill what's pleasing to this God. And so Paul's saying that these people are walking in such a way that their belly is their God. Their desires, their appetite, this inner desire to satisfy these simple things, that this is their God. And when I did that, I was like, that's awful, right? A lot of people are doing this. This is gross, it's weird, it's kind of disgusting. I'm gonna put this away because it bugs me. And he further says that they glory in their shame. They're acting, the way that they act and the way that they find their glory in these acts is shameful, right? They're finding glory in these shameful acts. And this is the type of lifestyle they have. And as I think about that, I think of coworkers, I think of friends, family members, and even reminded of ex-Christians, ex-believers, right? And I think that there is a reality that Paul could be talking that these people who are enemies of the cross are people who are claiming to be believers in that time. But they're living in this way. Their focus, as Paul continues in verse 19, he says their mindsets are on earthly things, on temporary things. And that's just not how believers should live, right? As believers, our life is dramatically different than the rest of the world. We're not going to live like the rest of the world does. They're not going to understand the decisions we make because we don't serve this thing, right? We serve a living God. And that's a contrast that Paul starts in verse 20. He says, but our citizenship is in heaven. Right, this world we live in now is just temporary. This house, these shoes, our jobs, our careers, our resumes, all this stuff, right, is just temporary. It's all gonna go away. This is so short in comparison to what awaits in heaven. Again, the enemies of the cross are focused on earthly things, but as believers, we're focused on what?
Eternal things.
On Christ, eternal things, absolutely. And let's just think about Jesus for a minute. I like talking about Jesus. Can you remind me, where is Jesus right now?
In heaven.
He's in heaven. Who said that?
I did. Do I get a prize?
Yeah. You know the categories that we were talking about on, was it Wednesday? No, Sunday.
Yeah.
I'm going to make a new category for who participates in church.
Yes.
That's a
participant.
Participant.
Congratulations. He has the gift of participation.
Yeah.
So, okay, yes. Good job, Pongo. So, Jesus is in heaven right now. Okay, so let's go back and talk about Jesus a little bit. And I was thinking about it, and I was thinking in contrast. So the enemies of the cross, right? For them, their God is their stomach, and for us, our God is a living God who is currently in heaven, right? So So now, do you remember what Isaiah said in chapter 6 when he was describing what's happening in heaven?
He's on the throne.
Another point for you, sir. Yes, he is on the throne, and there are these angelic creatures right now that are flying around, shielding themselves with their wings from his glory, and they're saying, holy, 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 all day long to this amazing, amazing God. That's the God that we serve and we love. Not only that, but he loves us. He knows us, right? And we know him, and we look forward to knowing him fully in the future. Now this Jesus, right? Let's not forget, when Jesus was walking around and living life, he lived a perfect life. He was sinless. Not only that, but he was beaten and he was crucified on the cross. And he died on the cross and bore our sins. After that, he was resurrected. Sorry, he was buried, and then he was resurrected. And then he received a new body. We're going to talk about this concept of new body in a second. And then after he received this body, he lived another 40 days with his disciples, right? With this new body. Everyone tracking with me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So then after that, what happened?
He ascended
into heaven, right? That's where Jesus is, in heaven. That's exactly right. So in Acts chapter 1, his disciples are following him, and he goes to this mountaintop or wherever he was, and then he starts ascending into heaven. And then as these people are looking at him, all of a sudden, I just imagine the sun's just in their eyes, and they can't really see him anymore. And then the Bible says that there's two men that were standing there. And they said, why are you staring into heaven like this? Don't you know that in the same way that Jesus ascended, he's going to come back? That is so exciting for us as believers. We look forward for this time that Jesus returns. Jesus is going to come back. That's our citizenship is not here. We look forward to heaven. We look forward to this day that Jesus returns. Verse 20, he says, but our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior. Our Savior is going to come back. We look forward to that. We eagerly await this, that Jesus is going to return. And, you know, this Jesus, by way of reminder, our Lord Jesus, he's going to transform our lowly bodies into what? And it's going to be like his glorious body. Remember when he was resurrected, he received this type of body? He received a different type of body, we read in Scripture. It doesn't give us too many details, but I feel like this type of body that he received is a body made more for heaven. And I think our bodies, these bodies that fail, that hurt, cancer-ridden, right? Our bodies are going to be transformed into the likeness of his glorious body. Notice the contrast there, right? The enemies of the cross, they glory in their shame. That's their glory, but we're going to have a type of glory. It's going to be different, right? We're going to have glorious bodies that are like Jesus. Anybody encouraged by that?
Yes.
That's cool. I thought that was encouraging to me anyway. So yeah, we eagerly await a Savior who will come back and transform our bodies to be like his glorious body. And in the power, it continues, by the power that enables him to subject all things to himself. And that same power in which everything is subject to Jesus, that's the same power that he's going to use to transform our bodies. And by his own authority, he doesn't have to answer to anyone, right? There's nothing that he can't do. And I love that. We eagerly await our Jesus. Our God is awesome. Do you agree?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
And as, again, all this section here, I think that it's information and it's something that Paul wants us to keep in mind for the purpose of standing firm, right? Because now we go to chapter 4, verse 1, and he says, therefore, right? That word is key, and it ties this next thought this conclusion from the previous verses. He says, therefore, my brothers, take note of the word he's using there, my brothers. It's a family term, right? Whom I love, I long for you. You bring me so much joy. You're like a crown. I want you to stand firm. And he quantifies it. He says, stand firm thus in the Lord. And then again, he says, my beloved. It's not like a harsh scolding, right? It's not like he's saying, you guys need to do this. You need to do that. No, it's like, oh, I love you guys so much. Don't you know you're my joy, my crown. I love you. And look, just because of the reality of what's happening, there's people who are walking as enemies of the Christ. Their God is their belly. They're worshiping, you know, the, these desires that they have. Their mindsets are on earthly things, these temporary things. Their future condition is hell, separation from God for eternity. And because of all of this, I encourage you and command you to stand firm. I love the way that he does it, and I probably should practice that more when talking with people. I think I have a tendency to be harsh. But, sorry, it's a tangent taken away from the point that Paul's heart for them is to stand firm in the Lord. And I think what he means by standing firm, I think it has to do with... let me just see where I wrote. In active pursuing and intimately knowing Jesus. I think that's what it means to stand firm in the Lord. We can stand firm in other things, right? We can stand firm in false doctrine. We can stand firm in things that are not in the Lord. I accidentally stumbled upon this quote from Abraham Lincoln. He says, be sure you put your feet in the right place, then stand firm. Right? Like, we can be in the wrong place. That was helpful to me. But yeah, I think to stand firm means to in active pursuing and intimately knowing Jesus. And standing firm is oftentimes, I mean, to me, when I think about it, I think stand firm, like something's going to happen. Like, hold this, stand firm. It has this connotation for me, like, I'm about to receive an impact, or I'm going to receive some sort of opposition or opposite force. Mm-hmm. And I think that is also part of what's happening in the Church of Philippians as Paul goes through this book. He's talked about it in different places, chapter 1, verse 29, he's talking about suffering for his sake. He's talking about these Judaizers. And it may not be that they're receiving persecution now or opposition now, but they might be. But look at Paul. Where is he? He's in prison. He's certainly seeing opposition. And that might freak them out a little bit when they heard, man, Paul is in prison. And so maybe in the cities that are nearby that Paul is encouraging them to be prepared for this type of opposition. Not necessarily just limited to persecution, but I would say... And anything that could push us back from knowing Christ would be a type of opposition that we need to stand firm against. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so let me ask you guys this question, time for interaction. When we think of standing firm, to stand firm in the Lord, how would you guys suggest that we go about that practically? How do we stand firm in the Lord?
I think the quote that you talked about from Abraham Lincoln, like, know what you're standing on first. And I think so often our idea of who Jesus is or who God is who we wish he was in our cultural context, mm-hmm. as opposed to actually looking in the Word for who he is. You know, we hear all kinds of things in our culture.
Mm.
Actually, God doesn't mean this, or he does mean this. And,
yep.
You know, and I think the beginning of that, of knowing how to stand firm, is knowing what you're standing on, and that's in Scripture.
Yeah, that's good.
To live a life that pleases the Lord.
Mm.
To really revel and rejoice in his teaching it and spreading that word and living through those works to bring others to Christ.
That's good. What else?
Encouraging one another and holding each other accountable to live the word, not just be doers of it.
Really,
I think seeking God's word when you don't feel like you're standing firm, or even when you are, and kind of like what Keely was saying, like knowing what you stand for in seeking it through God's word.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right underneath it says a practical application in verses 2 and 3 of Yudaya and Sinichi, like getting along and making peace, saying like they both are believers, they both, their names are both in the book of life, and to not let whatever, I don't know what the dispute is, but to stand firm in not letting that be divisive and not letting that destroy unity in the church.
Mm. Yeah, yeah, it's good. Because if standing firm is this pattern of life that is actively pursuing Jesus, Paul talks a lot about unity in this book, right? Mm-hmm. His heart is that they would be unified. Chapter 1, verse 27, he says, "That I may hear that you are standing firm in one spirit, with one mind striving side by side for the faith of the gospel." And I think that you're absolutely right. He puts this situation that he's heard about from Iodia and Syntyche? I don't know. Anybody have a better way of saying that? Okay. The situation between these two women. And it's interesting because look at how Paul writes to them. He says, "I entreat Iodia and I entreat Syntyche." He doesn't say, "I entreat Iodia and Syntyche." He says it twice. "I entreat Iodia, I entreat Syntyche." Like, he's not taking sides. He's being very careful as to what he's saying. And I think the emphasis, yes, Clayton, that we should not have this... Did you figure out a better way of saying it? No. Sorry. Easily distracted. I don't even know what I'll say.
Sorry.
Something about unity. So yeah, that they shouldn't. There shouldn't be divisions, right? Like this. If this situation was bad enough that Paul in prison, I don't even know how many miles away, was able to hear about this ongoing division, that he had to address it, like, you know, it was bad. And so Paul's saying, look, you guys need to get over this. And he's encouraging, right, in verse 3, "I ask you, true companion." It's debated. It's not clear. We don't really know who this is. It might be Luke, but we don't really know. But someone that is walking in a pattern that Paul talks about before, someone probably in like a leadership type position, that they would know who he's referring to. And he says, "You, true companion, help these women who have labored side by side with me in the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my fellow co-workers." Right? Paul definitely wants unity. He definitely wants them to work together and to stand firm, a continuous act of pursuing and knowing Jesus. Any questions about that section there, 2 through 3? Yeah, and I think Paul's thoughts are just, yeah, very purposeful in the way that he wrote that whole section from chapter 3 down to verse 2.
I'll say something real quick. It seems at first kind of odd to me that it says whose names are in the book of life, but that kind of puts things in perspective, just like what he said before with our citizenship in heaven. And when you consider these eternal things, then a disagreement here on earth between a couple people, it's like, mm-hmm. just, you know, agree. We're talking about one another whose names are in the book of life, our citizenship's in heaven. I mean, it doesn't, when you put it in the perspective of eternity, it's disagreements just seem kind of ridiculous. So. Or seem so small, I guess.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's really good. Thanks.
Yeah, I think about like how it's easy to get sidetracked with that. But in light of what he just said, it's like, grow up. Like, don't get those little knit kind of things. Like here we've got, like, these are people around you that are living and going to hell. And I've called you to something so much greater and imitating. And I often, it's hard for me sometimes when I hear Paul say, like, imitate me, because it seems like in our culture, it's like, wow, that just seems so prideful. But it's that, because he's so deeply standing firm in who Christ is, who Christ has made him to be, and confidence in what Christ has done in him. And so it's like there's just so many, greater things to be concerned about and taking and having it being firm in who Christ is and what he's done than to get caught up in some of the other things that we often do,
Yeah, that's really good. And I think going back to standing firm, I don't think that this is a type of standing in which we're stagnant. I think it's something that we're actively going to be moving and growing in our knowledge and union and relationship with Jesus Christ, which is maturity, right? And one thing, I didn't really know how to throw it in here, but I was thinking about, and I think Melissa actually was the one that first brought it to my attention, but going back to when Paul says, like, imitate me, if we as believers are supposed to imitate Paul, and Paul is encouraging others to imitate himself, does that mean that we as believers should be calling others to imitate ourselves? Would that make sense?
Yeah.
That
two of you, right. What's that?
That puts the pressure on.
Puts the pressure on?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
If I'm like, hey, guys, do what I do, it's like, oh, I better be doing the right thing.
And it's not from a standpoint of like pride or arrogance, right? It's like, no, you genuinely love Jesus. And as I think Jared talked about last week, like our response to
my example as encouragement.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we've all seen the blessings of certain decisions and the consequences of others. You know, I mean, it's almost kind of like raising kids. I think, like, you're raising your kids with the hope that they won't make some of the same mistakes you did because you know the consequences of those mistakes. So it sounds almost like kind of in a fatherly way of imitate me and...
Yeah, it's really good. So yeah, just something for us to think about as we mature in Christ. And I think it's good for us to, say, no, this is real. The reality is we're not in a hypothetical situation. People don't know Jesus. Each of you can think of coworkers and family and friends and believers that are no longer believers that are living in this pattern that Paul talks about. And in light of that, it is a grave situation, and we want to live in such a way that's pleasing to God, right? It's a joy, like, anyway. All right, well, let me pray for us, and we'll end our time here. Heavenly Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the relationship we get to have with you. Jesus, thank you for being such a wonderful, amazing, and awesome God. I'm just still blown away that people want to worship other things. And Lord, honestly, I just thinking about it today, I just feel like life's just hard and trying. And like Paul was saying, sometimes I just don't really want to be here on earth. I really want to be in heaven. And we look forward to your return, Jesus. We do pray that you would come quickly. In the meantime, I pray that we would all stand firm. I pray that we would grow in our knowledge of you. Help us not to be distracted by earthly things. Help us not to have faith that wavers, Lord. I pray for just unity in our church, that we'd be of the same mind, same spirit, God. I pray that we would all stand firm individually and together. It's true that the devil is like a lion prowling around looking for someone to devour. I pray that we'd be aware of the spiritual battle. Satan hates us and wants to destroy us. And thank you, God, that you are so much infinitely more powerful than him, and you've even given us authority over demons. But you told your disciples not to rejoice in that, but to rejoice that our names are written in the book of life. So we thank you, Lord, for this time, and we pray all these things in Jesus' name.
Amen.